We all understand civil rights. We all understand political rights. But a necessary and inseparable ingredient for justice has to be economic rights, has to be a base level of resource so that people can engage without a vulnerability of being exploited and extracted from simply because they have no resources.
From the ACLU, this is At Liberty. I'm Kendall Seismeyer, your host. Ah, the American dream, the pinnacle of success, rewarded to all who display hard work, give us their blood, sweat, and tears, and pick themselves up by their bootstraps when life knocks them down. Right? Wrong. This might be our culture's prevailing narrative, but it actually rarely bears out this way. The truth is, our system is full of inequities that put large swaths of people in our country at significant odds with building wealth. Intergenerational wealth, or the passing on of wealth within generations of a family, gives certain folks, namely white people, a huge leg up and leaves everyone else behind. Children born into families with wealth start with opportunity and avoid the burdens of debt. The saying goes, in order to make money, you need to have money. And if you don't have money, well, then it's just simply much harder to ever start a business, go to school, or buy a home. Enter baby bonds, an economic policy in which every child at birth receives an income-dependent, government-funded savings account, managed by federal, state, or local governments until that child reaches adulthood. The end goal? Breaking the cycle of poverty and closing the racial wealth gap to ensure economic stability for future generations.
We have a long, sordid history of exploitation and extractive of Black people and empowerment of white people. But the good news, the silver lining in this story, is that we know how to generate wealth for the masses of people. This time, we need to make sure we do it in an affirmatively inclusive way.
So today, we're exploring baby bonds and the national legislation that is seeking to create systemic equality nationwide. To start, I spoke with economist Derek Hamilton, founding director of the Institute on Race, Power, and the Political Economy at the New School, who has been at the helm of shepherding this idea and policy proposal forward. Derek, welcome to At Liberty, and thank you so much for joining me.
Kendall, I'm pleased to be here. Thank you for having me.
We love the enthusiasm. I'm so excited to be speaking with you. So I just want to get into it. Baby bonds is a term coined by you alongside your colleague, William Darity Jr. And this was back in 2010. Since then, baby bonds, the movement, has steadily built momentum and gained support nationwide. U.S. Senator Cory Booker and Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley have proposed a national baby bonds program through their American Opportunity Accounts Act. Other states have taken more local action. But I want to go back to the beginning and trace the origins of all of this. How did you come up with the idea of baby bonds, and what issues were you seeking to solve or address with it?
And in fairness, Kendall, Manning Marable, the late Manning Marable, was the first person that I'm aware of that uttered the term baby bonds.
Okay.
The policy was being described to him, and he said, oh, you mean baby bonds? And the name stuck and resonated.
Okay, I stand corrected. I love that. Good to give kudos to the people who came before us.
This is true. So the idea stems from a set of meetings from the Ford Foundation when they used to run their portfolio led by Kilolo Kijakazi entitled Building Economic Security Over a Lifetime. This group would convene, and we talk about the racial wealth gap. And the most obvious parsimonious solution to the racial wealth gap would be reparations. Well before our current political context in which reparations is being thought about in many places, before that, you'd utter the word reparation and people would roll their eyes and say, okay, give us something that we actually can implement. There were basically two impetus around where baby bonds stem from, or three. There's actually a third element. One is, what are some of the ways in which we could target race, if not being explicitly using the word race? That would be to use wealth and endow every child with some wealth so that they can generate economic security over their lifetime. The second impetus was building upon what we were learning from giants in the field, like Michael Sheridan in his book, Assets and the Poor, when he started to shift the conversation beyond income to understand asset poverty. And then out of that work came a genre of child savings accounts, individual development accounts, a whole lot of accounts aimed at providing poor people with mechanisms by which they could save and build up their savings. The lessons to me from that work was that the problems of inequality and racial disparity were not active savings, but rather passive savings. It wasn't a question of one group gets X amount of income and chooses to save out of that income versus one group had access to capital that put them in an asset that was going to passively appreciate over their life. The difference between a homeowner and a renter is a down payment. The difference between an entrepreneur and a worker is often capital to take that idea and bring it to market. So I emphasized assets. And then one other last point, Kendall, is experience. I mean, I grew up in Bedford-Stuyvesant, and my parents, through struggle, were able to afford me to go to an elite private school, Brooklyn Friends. And I could see that some of the differences in both the economic security as well as pathways and prospects for future were grounded in assets that those group of children had that kids growing up in Bed-Stuy did not have. So it became clear to me that often the difference between whether you're going to have economic security or not was going to be wealth.
Yeah, absolutely. Just to be clear for folks who are listening who might not be as familiar with terminology like the racial wealth gap or even the concept of intergenerational wealth, how would you introduce those ideas to someone who may not be as read in on those concepts?
So the racial wealth gap is dramatic. It is generally the case, there may be some ebbs and flows depending on the period, that the median wealth, the typical wealth of a Black household, is about a dime of the typical wealth of a white household. And what else we know is that it does not reduce with things like education. So if you compare Black and white people at different levels of education, the gap grows with education. So there's no amount of studying, there's no amount of hard work that individuals or groups of people can do to bridge the racial wealth gap. The racial wealth gap is grounded in capital. The ways in which wealth is generated for most Americans, it is wealth that begets more wealth. And that makes sense if one thinks about the ways in which people generate wealth.
Absolutely, it does. And I really, really appreciate what you said about the fact that you actually can't catch up by simply working hard or studying hard, that this is the time value of money is at play in a way such that there's really nothing that you can do other than something like baby bonds to rectify or ameliorate this kind of gap. So when you were originally thinking about what do we do, how do we propose something new that isn't reparations, that is perhaps more palatable at some level to the American public, to the electorate, to folks in Congress, what were you thinking about? Were you looking to other countries and seeing what they do? Because a lot of other nations kind of in our GDP bracket, if you will, have devised some kind of similar program and implemented it. What did you take from other countries and their programs? And what would be similar or different about what they are proposing in the United States?
And really quick, reparations and baby bonds are complements rather than substitutes.
Oh, for sure.
In the sense that reparations is retrospective.
Different things.
But what baby bonds does is in a prospective way guarantees that you have a birthright to capital. So it does, it addresses inequality and inclusion in a prospective way. But the answer is, I looked within America. So we can go back and hearken to a period of the New Deal, the post-war period, where we provided GIs returning from World War II with capital finance to purchase a home, capital finance to go to college for free, where we, you know, there are plenty of American policies that were put into place. We can even look at Social Security. I mean, Social Security became a mechanism to provide universal pensions as we age into the twilight of our life to ensure we had insurance. But what we didn't have is something for young adults who were beginning a pathway of building economic security. When they reached their adulthood, they needed a nest egg, so to speak, so that they could not only be able to generate wealth, but even facilitate family formation. Now, there's also another lesson from this American history. When we implemented all these programs, we did them in racially biased ways. We designed the policies, we managed the policies, and implemented them in racially exclusive ways. In fact, we were able to create an asset-based white middle class for our first time, but we didn't do so for Black people. And that's another big reason why we have this racial wealth gap today.
So baby bonds, as it's been implemented in the States, thus far, it has mostly pertained to folks who were eligible for Medicaid, families who had children that would be covered by Medicaid. As it exists in the bill proposed by Representative Ayanna Pressley and Senator Cory Booker, it is a universal policy. Do you agree with that? Should it be? Is that the way to win fans and pass this legislation nationally?
Well, it's universal, but progressively seeded. So in other words, everybody doesn't get the same amount. The size of the account that the government reserves for you is based on your family's economic circumstance. So that part makes it progressive. Now, it's not explicitly race-based. What makes it race-conscious is that the outcome is tied to a domain by which Black and white people have very little overlap, and that's wealth. And then, you know, states are limited in their capacities to finance the accounts because they face budget constraints that the federal government does not. So the states have generally chosen babies that are universally born in poverty, which sadly are overrepresented by certain marginalized racial groups. That's their mechanism of implementation and inclusion.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes sense. Smaller pools and perhaps even the implementation of baby bonds in a state like Connecticut would then help us see through its implementation if there is ways that people would want to change it nationally. You know, it's like working out the kinks on a smaller scale, if you will. Okay, so as far as actually describing the mechanisms of baby bonds and the numbers kind of behind how much someone would accrue by the time they are 18, could you just walk us through what the kind of nuts and bolts process would look like?
It's kind of analogous to Social Security in that the accounts are held by the state. Be it the federal government at the federal level or state government at the local level. You know, one difference between the state and the federal program is that the states will intentionally try to build up those reserves in a similar way that they do with managing the pensions of workers that work at the state. So not only do you get the initial endowment, you have the treasurer managing the accounts to make them as large as possible in a responsible way. So then when the recipient becomes a young adult, then they can use those accounts towards some wealth-building activity, like a down payment on a home, or to finance the education without debt, and then finally some capital to start a business.
So I'm curious, you know, you've been working on this issue and talking about this issue and thinking about this issue for a number of years now. You know, this was proposed back in 2010. Has your perspective changed on the program or the economic policy? And has anything that you've seen shifted how you view the either the policy itself or the implementation of it?
Its impact was centered on wealth. And centered on wealth because of what wealth can do for you, the functional role that wealth can play, not the outcome, but the agency that wealth affords. So we think about wealth as a security, but wealth is also an input, an investment. Wealth lets you do things. So I've kind of always understood that. But some other dimensions that I've grown to appreciate the more I've been engaged with this policy, is how wealth can yield things like love. The simple outcome of love itself, being able to, you know, there's a great emphasis on the role of the family and economic outcomes. Maybe we should think about that relationship a little differently. And I got a lot of this from Diane Stewart. Diane Stewart is a professor at Emory University who's been talking a lot about Black love and how properly resourced families can facilitate greater love. But well, whether it's Black people, white people, or any people, you really want to have resources so that you can make good choices, stable choices, and something as humanistic as love. That's one outcome. The other outcome, Kendall, is civic engagement. Think about the state's relationship with low income and Black people throughout history. There's a healthy level of distrust that has emerged. There is a familiarity of the state doing not always the best thing in their favor. Well, this changes the relationship. Something as dear to a parent as their child. What can happen when the state makes an investment and something that you care so much about as your child at birth? How does that change the relationship between you and the state? I believe that this program can lead to greater civic engagement.
Yeah, I mean, it's the idea of like you invest in me and I'll invest in you. The mutuality there, it makes a lot of sense. I love the point about love. I think there is so much to be said about stability and safety and how those things offer opportunity to love other people outside of yourself and build healthy relationships. That is both fascinating, really important, and I'm really glad that you brought it up. Shout out to Diane Stewart. We're all going to read her work after this. That is really, really interesting. Okay, so what are the criticisms of the policy? What have your critics said that you've heard, and why are they wrong?
I mean, you get the similar tropes about, are they going to misuse these accounts? Are they going to take it in and do something that they're not, that's going to be detrimental to their own well-being? Those are your unfortunate standard critiques in the current paradigm in which we live, where we treat poor people as surplus populations and believe that we have to manage their decisions, in which we don't understand that our most treasured resource is people, and that properly resourcing people is not only good for them, but good for us all, because it creates a dynamism of activity. You know, basically, I'd say that to that critique, we need to reconceptualize how we think about resources going to people in place, not as simple costs on our state, but rather investments in our whole economy. I guess some of the other vulnerabilities of the program is the gestation period that it takes before the accounts go out the door. And then, you know, another thing to recognize, we don't have a silver bullet policy that's going to redress all of our insecurities and need to invest in people. Baby bonds is a big piece of the puzzle, but not the piece.
Yeah, I mean, it is one stab at it, for sure. It's not going to fix all of racism in America and all of systemic inequality, but it does seem to make a real dent in the racial wealth gap and help level the playing field a little bit more than it is right now. We all have to work in various ways to chip away at inequality everywhere we see it, right? This is one way to do that. So I appreciate you mentioning that it's not a silver bullet fix.
You know, we all understand civil rights. We all understand political rights. But a necessary and inseparable ingredient for justice has to be economic rights, has to be a base level of resource so that people can engage without a vulnerability of being exploited and extracted from simply because they have no resources. Somebody entering any transaction with nothing, that's not a transaction. They're either at the whim of the charitable inkling of somebody with resources or their vulnerability of exploitation of another agent with resources. So we need a society that identifies what are the essential ingredients for prosperity. What are the essential ingredients for people to prosper and ensure that we deliver those things with adequate access, quantity, and quality that's not rationed by another agent because they have the power of the purse and the ability to determine price in a rationing way. And this is not about capitalism or socialism. This is about justice. And in this nomenclature, capital has to be one of the key ingredients and main features.
Yeah, because capital is power in America. So if you're going to ameliorate any kind of abuses of power or undo any kind of power structures, it has to be a part of the equation. That makes a lot of sense. That was beautifully put. Thank you so much for that, Derek. And thank you so much for all of this. Thank you for all your work and for speaking with me today.
Oh, Kendall, this is great. I wish we were in person, then we could have a toast in fellowship.
Let's toast to Derek and his work. Baby Bond sounds like such a promising way to help level the playing field so that we can all see opportunity in our lives. At the ACLU, we are in support of this national legislation that would implement baby bonds. That national legislation has been drafted by Representative Ayanna Pressley of Massachusetts and Senator Cory Booker of New Jersey. Representative Ayanna Pressley joined me to discuss why she's passionate about baby bonds and how she plans to get it done. Representative Pressley, welcome to At Liberty, and thank you so much for joining me.
Good morning. Great to be with you. I heard, policy is my love language, and I heard a rumor that you care about that too. So I'm happy to be here.
We do. Amazing. Thank you so much. So I want to start with just the basics. You and Senator Cory Booker are reintroducing baby bonds to Congress through a bill called the American Opportunity Accounts Act that ideally would allow every American child to have economic opportunity as a birthright and help close the racial wealth gap. We've spoken with economist Derek Hamilton, who coined the concept, about what inspired his economic proposal. But I'm wondering for you as a congresswoman, when did baby bonds come onto your radar and why have you felt it was so important to support?
Well, first, I'm a huge admirer of Derek Hamilton. And in my role on the Financial Services Committee, which handles everything from consumer protection to obviously banking, financial services, housing, homelessness, student debt, that's an issue that I've led on in that committee role. I'm always looking for legislative tools and levers that will close the racial wealth gap, which is a $10 trillion crisis. So that is a problem for everyone. I also represent one of the most unequal districts in the country, the Massachusetts 7th. There was a report done, a color of wealth report done by the Federal Reserve of Boston that puts wealth for a Black Boston family at $8. And for a white Boston family, $247,500. And so, you know, there are many variables that contributed to those inequities, but I certainly do think much of it comes down to home ownership, asset, and wealth building. So I'd say about several years or so.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. It makes a lot of sense that this would be something that you would want to get behind. I also am interested in, you know, perhaps you have your own personal experience. I think many Americans do of navigating economic injustice, of navigating barriers to whether that be education or homeownership or entrepreneurship. How would you relate baby bonds or the promise or potential of baby bonds to your own life or your own experiences?
Well, I mean, I was raised in a single parented household and certainly saw many of the inequities and injustices and indignities that my mother endured raising me alone and as a Black woman. And certainly those experiences have formidably shaped me. I mean, my mother came home and told me many stories about training white men that were later promoted over her. So, you know, I think the injustices that I had a front row seat to my mother navigating certainly have formidably shaped my agenda. Specifically, I'll name the issue of student debt because I know I'm no anomaly there. So, you know, if we're going to say education's life's great equalizer and that we allegedly live in a meritocracy, you know, when we continue to put education, higher education, farther and farther out of reach, it makes it that much more impossible. And so like many students, I took out loans. And like many Black borrowers, I defaulted on those loans. I did pay them off, but it took me some 20 years to pay them off. If you take a policy like baby bonds, if I had had a targeted bond in that way for families in the lowest socioeconomic bracket of which I would have qualified at the age of 18, because you could also let it sit there as an asset and continue to accrue, right? I would have had anywhere from $18,000 to $24,000 to potentially supplement my education or just to stabilize me in other ways writ large. So, you know, student debt is an economic justice issue. It's a gender justice issue, and it's a racial justice issue. Black Americans were locked out of every major federal relief program in this country, from the Homestead Act to the GI Bill. The practice of redlining still persists and is, you know, very targeted. We have appraiser bias. So there are all these ways in which I would just take, you know, my home community as an example, where Black Americans have been deprived and denied the opportunity to build generational wealth. So even where there have been strides, those strides have mostly been in the space of increased income, which is not the same thing as generational wealth.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for detailing that. And you're right. This is something that isn't unique to specifically you. I mean, college debt is a huge issue in our country. And it's very clear to me that the American Opportunity Accounts Act could help ameliorate some of the issues and disparities that you've described. Could you introduce and talk to us about this bill in specific? What does it include?
Well, it's very simple, you know, actually, like most impactful policies, they're pretty direct and pretty simple. When a child is born, there would be a $1,000 bond or seed account. The Department of Treasury would then make payments into that over the next 18 years. Depending again on where you fall in the socioeconomic scheme of things, those deposits could be as much as $2,000. And then in 18 years, again, it's up to that individual if they want to allow that to continue to, you know, accrue value, or if they want to take those funds out. So the three permissible uses is that you can purchase a home. So again, asset and wealth building, equity. You can start a business, you know, and Black women are the fastest growing entrepreneurs and small business owners in the country right now. But we still experience disparate lending when it comes to financial institutions. So to be able to withdraw anywhere from $18,000 to $24,000, that could be very impactful and game changing for someone. The other option is to pursue education. So education, entrepreneurship, starting a business, or homeownership. And I should add that although Senator Booker, and I have to give him a shout out because we've done a lot of work together, even where we have seen obstruction in passing our bills federally, we have seen progress of these policy responses in states across the country. And baby bonds, with baby bonds in particular, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts has a bill before the state legislature. There are already baby bonds programs underway in Washington, D.C., Connecticut, California. I think after the pandemic, people are more open to those policies that go as far and as deep as the hurt. And if they're not going to undo centuries of harm, at least they are charting a more equitable and just path forward.
Yeah, I was actually going to ask about that specifically. You know, I think you mentioned we've seen this act proposed or considered in states across the country. Connecticut was the first state to pass similar legislation in 2021. But I think, you know, what can be difficult with forward-looking policy is that we likely won't feel the impact or see the impact for years. Baby bonds are given to babies. Those babies will have to grow up. And I imagine it's hard, especially in the climate today, to make policy that won't yield results for a certain period of time. How do you think about approaching that challenge?
Well, I think most lawmakers are used to the fact that you might not even see in your own lifetime efforts that you have championed. So some of that is just the legislative process. But the other is that I really do believe we are supposed to be better ancestors than descendants. Again, this is one of the reasons why, you know, I champion the work of student debt cancellation and so many other precise policies in this way, because you are delivering a love letter to future generations. You know, those that low-income families that live in poverty or families that have been denied the ability to build generational wealth, the harm that has been done was very precise. And so we need to advance policies that are just as precise and just as prescriptive as the discriminatory, negligent policies were, because every injustice is one that was codified in a budget or in law. You know, it didn't just like happen in the ether. So, so the path forward, and what I talked to my colleagues about, is sort of disrupting that algorithm and doing that through lawmaking.
Yeah, absolutely. I love what you said, a love letter to future generations. That is such a beautiful idea. And I really would love if all Congress people would think of it that way. So as we wrap up here, Representative Presley, I just want to ask, what needs to be done to get this bill passed? How can folks at home who are listening to this, who are hearing you speak about it, support you and advocate for the implementations of baby bonds, both in their states and nationwide?
Sure. Well, I think the first thing is just to start with your own congressional delegations. Ask your member of Congress, ask your senator if they are on this bill and if they're supportive of it. Again, it's the American Opportunity Accounts Act. The shorthand way that we refer to it is baby bonds, because it is a bond for a baby at birth in those lowest socioeconomic brackets. And then again, because there are states that have advance this policy while we're seeking to pass the legislation federally, you can always suggest this to your governor, your state treasurer, or to your mayor. States are competitive, and so cities often will replicate best practices. So start with your own elected officials and ask them to sign on to the bill.
Just to follow up on that, to reach out to your elected officials, you're a member of Congress. You receive a lot of messages, I'm sure. What can you say to people about that skepticism that they might feel or jadedness when they hear, call your representatives or email them, reach out to your local politicians or electeds? How do you respond?
Yeah, never underestimate the power of one. I can't tell you one of my bills that was signed into law by President Biden, the Post-Disaster Mental Health Act, to provide people with psychological first aid, if you will, in the wake of natural disasters, domestic terrorism, which is growing. That was a bill that I I wrote because a constituent wrote my office. She was a survivor of the marathon bombing in Boston, and she didn't have any physical wounds. And so because she didn't have physical wounds, she had not been able to access the behavioral health that she needed, but she was traumatized, right? And so we worked for 2 years with that constituent, Manya Chalinsky, and went through the necessary processes to finalize that bill, get it to committee, report it out of committee to the floor for a vote, and ultimately signed by the president into law. And I will tell you, in my office, every week, usually on Mondays, I go over all the mail stats. How many letters came in? How many emails came in? What were they about? How many of them were individual letters? How many of them were from organized campaigns? And it is very impressionable, you know, it stays with me. And, those are often stories and an advocacy that I'm lifting when I then am going to other people, being an ambassador of that issue that you championed. And the other thing I don't want people to forget is we're accountable to you. Whether you voted for me, whether you don't vote for me, whether you never vote at all, you are still our constituents. You don't elect saviors, you elect partners. And so part of partnership is accountability. So you should always feel empowered. You know, the Congress is the people's house. City Hall is the people's house. State House is the people's house. So, come up and just take up all types of space.
That's good, Congresswoman Presley. That's very good. Thank you so much for your time and for speaking with us about baby bonds. Really appreciate all of your work and you coming to chat here with us today.
Thank you, Kendall. Take good care.
A special note before we close, on March 26th, the 6 Degrees podcast is hosting an important episode featuring our LGBTQ rights work. On the episode, actor and host Kevin Bacon is joined with actress Laverne Cox and our very own Chase Strangio, Deputy Director for Transgender Justice at the ACLU. Together, they'll discuss the urgent update on the issues facing trans rights and how we can all be part of protecting them. Be sure to catch it on March 26th, wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks so much for listening. If you enjoyed this episode, please subscribe to At Liberty wherever you get your podcasts and rate and review the show. We really appreciate the feedback. Until next week, stay strong. At Liberty is a production of the ACLU, produced by me, Kendall Seesmeyer, and Vanessa Handy. This episode was edited by the folks at Ultraviolet Audio. Genesis Mike Pio is our intern.